guess the best way to get things started is to talk a little bit about where we are in the cycle. But before we even do that, does credit still lead right now? Because there's been a dislocation between how credit investors and equity investors are seeing assets. Does credit lead at the moment?
I think that that's a complicated question because it's so geographical at this point. I think clearly in the United States, the historical question is, what are credit spreads in the United States telling us? And as credit spreads get tighter and tighter and tighter, the system gets tighter and tighter and tighter. And when those let go, it has knock-on effects. And I think that is the story of 07, 08. Mm-hmm. That said, I think coming out of the Great Recession, the recoveries were so different across the globe, and the government actions that were taken were so different, that we see different cycles in Europe and in Asia and in the United States. And I'm not entirely certain that whatever cycles we see going forward will necessarily correlate exactly the same way. And when I think about what's sitting on my desk right now, it ranges from a rescue financing of a distressed company in Italy to NPLs in Spain to a distressed company in India to a regular way private loan in the United States and everything in between.
So how do you think about taking risk then? Where do you want to be taking the most risk and where do you want to be pulling back on risk if we're at different points of the cycle depending on geography?
So I think in par credit in the United States, the biggest market in the credit space, I think you want to be keeping it in the middle of the fairway right now. I think that the risk curve is quite flat. I don't think you're getting paid as much for going out on the risk spectrum in the U.S. as you should be. There's all sorts of arguments that say, well, the economy is doing well, and therefore the risk in the United States is just inherently less. But at the end of the day, I just don't think you're getting paid enough extra to take extra risk in the United States. I think broadly overseas, there's a lot of situations where you can bring value to the investment through NPLs that you help with the collections, through restructurings in Asia, and helping private loans in countries that don't have the same developed banking systems. And I think there's a tremendous amount of opportunity there. But those are all situations where you're bringing a skill, where you're bringing more than just capital.
So you have to be an active participant adding value to the situation rather than watching it passively and say, hey, this is time for me to get in.
Right. Quite simply, these are not markets where you're going and participating in beta.
Okay, got it. And how long does it then take for these kinds of investments to produce the return that you're looking for?
Well, I think it's twofold. One is some of these investments can take 6 months to a year to actually get done. Mm. And that's something we're not used to in the United States. And therefore, you have to have a tenacity to work on these investments for a very, very long time.
You've got to have high conviction, too.
Right. You have to have high conviction, and you have to have a team structured to be able to put resources against those investments. And then secondly, some of them can work out in as much as a year, and then some of them could be a five-year journey. Mm-hmm. And you have to make sure you're pricing the time risk, you're pricing the effort risk, and you're pricing the risk of it not getting done.
Okay. Now, you've been very active in China for a long time here. There's obviously a troubled relationship right now between China and the U.S. At the very best, we could say that we don't know where it's headed. Does that give you pause in terms of your deal-making in China? Do you pull back on what you're willing to do as you wait and see how everything pans out?
No, I mean, I don't think so. I think we as an institution have a big commitment to Asia and to China in particular. We have over 80 people in the region. And I think that it definitely adds an element right now of trying to understand not just what's happening locally in governments across Asia, but now we have to think about what our government is doing as well. I do believe that it will be worked out. I know Secretary Mnuchin and a delegation is going over there on Thursday, and we hope progress is made. And it does add another level of things to think about.
Yes.
But I think long-term thinkers look at this situation and say, both countries need each other as trading partners. Both countries want a trading relationship that succeeds in a rational manner, and I hope that that is what prevails.
All right, you might be a long-term thinker, though, but so many in the market aren't. Yet we've seen the equity market, for instance, the bond market, be able to shrug off a lot of bad news, become numb to bad news. Why do you think that is? Maybe there is no one answer to that. No matter the case, it is, that's what it is. So what happens when there is a tipping point, when you eventually get a situation where investors treat bad news as bad news?
That is one of my biggest concerns, because that will be a surprise, because fighting in Syria didn't seem to bother anybody. Trade wars don't seem to bother anybody. And the definition of bad news, you could pick almost anything you've read on the front page of a newspaper for the last 4 years and roll the clock back 15 years, and any one of them would have caused a major market collapse. And I think that there's a good side to it and a bad side to it. One of it is, I think people are reacting more rationally to, okay, what is the real impact? I think the downside to it is, I think people are using the fact that the market keeps trading up as justification for why not to worry about these things. And short-term news is leading to short-term, you know, ignoring short-term news leads to the market going up in the short term, which leads to being self-reinforcing. And I don't know what that piece of news could be. I worry it'll be something that nobody can process, like a cyber hack or, you know, some major terrorist event or something like that, or a computer going awry. And what I fear is what will happen then is the overreaction, because people will take the sum total of everything they wish they didn't ignore or maybe moderated a little bit and feel like they got caught with their hand in the cookie jar. But markets are resilient, and they do correct themselves and then continue to move forward.